Okay, so I think we can continue. Remember the point where we were left yesterday? We were discussing the heat equation in our framework, and we were proving some basic properties of this heat equation. Well, first of all, we had an integration by parts. Led us to the fact that the identity, the Laplacian has mean value equal to zero, and this leads also to the fact that this quantity is constant along the heat flow. Okay, analogous properties can be proved basically by the same argument you can prove maximum and minimum principle. So what I mean that if f at time zero is greater than a constant or smaller than another constant, then this inequality is preserved at all later times. And the argument is really the same. You just, for instance, for this let's say for the inequality from below, you just take phi of z equal to z minus c plus and compute the derivative integral of phi of ft dm. Again, you can use the integration by parts formula to show that this derivative is equal to zero, and then this derivative is non-negative, and then out of this you get that if this quantity is zero at time zero, it remains zero. Okay. Well, okay. So all these properties, in particular, imply that if you start from a function f zero, which is non-negative, and with integral of f zero, dm is equal to one. These two properties are preserved in time, okay? And so these are the two properties which characterize probability densities. So if I call mu zero f zero m, this will be a probability measure in X, an absolutely continuous probability measure in X, absolutely continuous with respect to m. And then well, as I said, sometimes I will use the notation ft. I never use this as a partial derivative. This for me will be f of tx, will be just an index. Then ftm will still be a probability measure. So it will be crucial now for the go things we are going to say later on that we understand, in some sense, this curve in a dual way, either as a curve in L2. From this point of view, but also as a curve we will see in the space of probability measures. Okay, this will be absolutely crucial. And we would like to understand the properties of this curve in the space of probability measures relative to the Wasserstein distance. Okay? Very well. And in fact, the first property that we want to check, in some sense related to this philosophy, is the entropy. Let us compute the energy dissipation rate of the entropy. Okay, so this means that I want to compute the derivative of the entropy of mu t along the heat flow. okay? So where mu t is precisely this curve. Okay, so this is d over dt of ft log ft. And then here you get 1 plus log ft delta ft dm. So here I'm using the equation. And since the Laplacian has mean value 0, if you want to, you can drop immediately this constant. And then you integrate by parts. Okay, maybe let me assume for simplicity, in order to avoid any technical problem related to the logarithm near 0, that ft is greater than a positive constant. Okay? I'm working with the curve made by functions which are bounded from 0, so I have no regularity problem related to the logarithm here. And of course here I'm using that m is a finite measure. This is something I can't do in general, but this is one of the cases where working with a finite m simplifies a lot. And so under this assumption I can really integrate by parts. And here I get the gradient of the logarithm star minus gradient of ft star dm, and eventually I can apply the chain rule, and this is minus the integral of nabla ft square over ft dm, okay, star. Of course, all these gradients, all these derivatives are the relaxed derivatives, which are precisely the derivatives for which we developed this calculus. Okay? Okay, let me write here this statement and so we know that the energy dissipation rate is given by this functional. This function has many interesting properties. First of all, again, I can use the chain rule to write this in terms of Cheeger energy. So this is equal to 4 times the derivative of the square root of f square dm, which is 8 times the Cheeger energy, because the Cheeger energy has the normalization 1 over 2 of the square root of f. And so this is a kind of lower semi-continuous functional in L1. Because this function is lower semi-continuous in L2, as you remember. And a non-trivial property which plays an important role, we will see, which is convexity. Convexity is not obvious from this representation, you see, because the square root is involved here, which is a concave function. So the best way to prove convexity, I just give you the basic idea, is to use to work with this representation. It is this representation which gives you convexity. And let's say it comes from the fact that this map is convex, let's say, in R. You can check that this map is convex, is jointly convex. And out of this, then you can easily check that this map also is convex. And of course, you have to use the convexity properties of the relaxed gradient. Okay. So this is an interesting functional, which is called also Fisher information. It appears, for instance, in the information theory. And in our field, it's really important because it really gives you the rate of dissipation of the entropy along the heat flow. Okay, so this more or less closes for the moment the so-called Eulerian point of view, or if you want, the H side of the Sobolev theory. And now we start to discuss the W side of the Sobolev theory. Which, roughly speaking, we will see is the Lagrangian side. Okay, first of all, a few historical remarks. Well, of course, the W definition became popular with the theory of distributions in the 50s, and is just based on integration by parts. So if you are in Rn, so the weak derivatives are defined by the validity of this integration by parts formula, okay? But actually, it is less known that a lot of time before, in 1901, Levy proposed a completely different, a quite different approach to what we call now Sobolev spaces, which in the same years of the theory of distributions eventually was revisited by Fugleda. And what I'm going to do to define Sobolev spaces in metric measure spaces is to follow this point of view and not this point of view. Why? Because in some sense this point of view is based on some regularity property of the measure. Right. To have a good integration by parts formula, you need a good measure on your space. If I want to make a really general theory, and if you want to avoid this assumption, you should. Basically, the approach of Levy and then of Fuglede is to consider a kind of one-dimensional integration by parts formula. Which is something that is much less restrictive because it is related basically to the one-dimensional Lebesgue measure. And the one-dimensional integration by parts formula is in the abstract, so if you consider a curve, well, you can write it classically as f of gamma 1 minus f of gamma 0 equal to the integral between 0 and 1 on nabla f of gamma t, gamma prime of t dt. Okay? This is standard. And maybe in a more abstract way, you could write it in this way, which also clarifies the structure of this formula, that the integral on the boundary of gamma, if you think of gamma as a current, really, the integral on the boundary of gamma with an appropriate choice of the orientations is equal to the integral on gamma of the gradient of f. So really, this corresponds to the integral on this current gamma of the one form associated to the gradient of f. Okay? And so the definition of Levy and Fuglede is that f So let's say between quotes, and then I will make it precise. If, let's say, there exists a gradient vector field. Okay, of course, the Levy and Fugler, the definition was in Rn. Such that the integral on the boundary of gamma of f is equal to the integral on gamma of f for almost every curve gamma. Okay? So you can really view this again as an integration by parts formula, you see, but it's along curves and along almost all curves, because of course since f is discontinuous and also, so since this function might be discontinuous, it's not reasonable to impose a regularity along all curves. You may know that a Sobolev function is also continuous along almost every line, not all along all lines. Okay, so now the problem is how to define almost every, and this is where the contribution also of Fugler that was very important. And then this approach has been revisited, let's say, roughly 10 years ago by Sean Mungallingham. Koskela, Hainon and Koskela. And 3 years ago, we came to this problem with Gillian Savarin, and again, we gave a new definition and the new concept of almost every curve, which is the one I'm going to adopt. A posteriori, our theory coincides with the other theories, but okay, maybe I will not give details about this fact. Okay, so maybe, yeah. Okay, what happens if you are on a metric space? If you are on a metric space, of course, you don't have vector fields, really. And so you turn this into an inequality. Okay, maybe I will call the function g. So this function is in L2, and you require that this inequality is true. Remember that now this makes sense in a metric space, because this, as usual, is the difference of the values of f at the endpoints of the curve, while the curvilinear integral can be still defined using the metric derivative. Okay? So, provided here I say almost every absolutely continuous curve, this object is well defined. But still, I have left the quotes because I have to tell you what we mean by almost every curve. Okay, and here really, in our paper, we put forward some ideas from optimal transportation with the concept of test plan. So take a probability measure pi on space of AC2, we say that pi is a test plan if all marginals of pi, so ET sharp of pi, are bounded by some constant times m. So these are measures, and I want that all these measures should be bounded, have a bounded density, uniform in time, with respect to m. So maybe sometimes I will use as a notation C of p to denote the smallest constant that you can put in this inequality. And, okay, maybe I write this just as a reminder for these concepts. Explicitly, this means that if you integrate phi of gamma t d pi of gamma, you should be able to bound this integral with the C integral of phi dm for any phi non-negative. Okay? This is the explicit translation of this inequality between measures. Okay. And then by duality, we can say what is almost every curve. So we say that P holds, that a property P relative to curves holds almost everywhere, holds, let's say, two almost everywhere, if, so there is a power two here involved in this definition, if pi of all curves gamma such that P of gamma fails is equal to zero for any test plan pi. Okay, but duality, so the a property which is pi negligible for any pi test plan pi is said to be true almost everywhere. And so, in this way, we have given a precise meaning to this inequality, right? And so now this is a real definition.
Sorry, can you explain, is it two almost everywhere?
Two.
Why there's the two?
Well, because, you know, inside this definition, there is an integrability, because a priori if you change, I mean, this is a part maybe of a more general theory where you could study H1P and W1P. So the role of this exponent appears here because you are taking probabilities concentrated on AC2. Although, of course, I'm dealing in this lecture solely with the case P equal 2. I wanted to emphasize that this definition depends on the choice of an exponent. Right. Okay. And I will call these objects weak upper gradient. A function g having this property I will call weak upper gradient. Okay? So the weak upper gradients are the class of functions g with satisfying this inequality for almost every curve. Okay, and then I can define a W12 Sobol space . Say, let me put already the summability here. So it's simply the space of functions for which you have at least one upper gradient, in a weak upper gradient in L2. Okay. Okay, a few propositions, a few properties of weak upper gradients. So properties, well, is a lattice. And is also a convex closed set in L2, and so because of these properties that I will not prove, but they are not so difficult, because of these properties you can define, you can take again the element with minimal norm. And I will call it Nabla DF weak. Okay, to distinguish from the other one, which was obtained, remember, by approximation with Lipschitz functions, I will use W instead of star. And again, because of this lattice property, this is not only minimizes the L2 norm, but it minimizes also, is minimal almost everywhere, in the sense that I already described for relaxed gradients. And another interesting property is that if F is in W12 XDM, then for almost every curve gamma, one is first of all that the composition is a W12 function in 0,1. So in some sense we really go back to one dimensional Sobolev spaces on the real line, and the derivative in the sense of distributions of this real valued function on the real line almost everywhere. For almost every t. So you see that really in this way we go back to a pointwise description. And okay, maybe I will not give the proof of this fact. I for those who want to work on it, maybe I just give you the key technical lemma which allows to prove this. So the proof is based on this So assume that you are in this situation. You have a function h and you have a function g in L1 or 0,1. And you know that you can bound the increments of h with g. But this not for all S&T, but only for almost every S&T. Okay, then this is a criterion for membership to W11. Then H belongs to W11 01, and the derivative in the sense of distributions of H is less than G for almost everywhere. Okay, once you prove this calculus lemma, it's not difficult to get to apply the calculus lemma along almost every curve to get to this property. Okay, and now we are going to discuss the relation between H and W spaces. So the theorem, which is surprisingly requires no assumption, is that H is equal to W. Okay, a posteriori, I mean, these two spaces are the same and the gradients are the same. Okay, so now I start to discuss the two inequalities and the two inclusions. Okay, if you have in mind the classical theory, there is always an easy inclusion. The easy inclusion in the classical and also in this theory is that H is contained in W. So the functions that you are able to approximate with smooth functions always satisfy an integration by parts formula. And of course, this comes with the proof that the gradient W is smaller than the gradient star almost everywhere. Okay? So, first of all, let me start to discuss this easy case, while the other one we will see is much less trivial. Okay, so let's take a function in H. In H12. So I know that I can write f as the limit in L2 of fh. And remember that the second characterization of relaxed slopes I gave, I can write nabla f star df star as the strong L2 limit. So I can find an appropriate sequence for which is equal to the limit of the, where these are the slopes and FH are Lipschitz in X. Okay. Okay. Now, the first observation is that the slopes are weak upper gradients. For Lipschitz functions. Okay, so if you have a function which is Lipschitz, then df belongs to wug of f. Let's say, let me call this function h maybe. And this is easy to check because you have the pointwise inequality. I mean, you start from the pointwise inequality that d over dt of f composition with gamma. This is really a pointwise inequality. Let's say at any point where the composition is differentiable, you have that this is less than So at any point where the function is differentiable and there is a metric derivative, you have really a pointwise inequality that you can easily check, because you know, the slope is really obtained taking the supremum, and so on. And then you integrate this inequality. By integration, you get that for any curve, actually. So not only a weak upper gradient, but it is an upper gradient, because this property is true on along any curve. By integration. For any gamma. Okay. And so in particular, you have a weak upper gradient. And now, the key point to conclude is the stability of weak upper gradient. Which says, okay, so let me put in this form that if FH converge to F in L2 and DFH and GH belong to WUG of FH and GH converge to G strongly in L2, I mean, this is, again, like in the classical theory, it's a kind of closure property of the gradient operator. Then G belongs to WUG of F. Actually, the property is true, like in the classical theory, also under weak convergence of G. But, okay, for the purpose of this lecture, it is sufficient for me to prove it with strong convergence. But the usual trick of convexification, one can reduce to the case of strong convergence, right? But actually, it is true under weak convergence. Okay, so for the moment, I will give you later on the proof of stability. Let's see how we can use the stability to get this inclusion and this inequality. Okay, so now apply the stability. With the GH equal to DFH, which we know are weak upper gradients, to get that since these GH are converging to the relaxed gradient, to get that nabla DF star belongs to the weak upper gradients of F. And this implies, at the same time, that F is in W, because I have found a weak upper gradient, and the pointwise minimality property tells me that the weak upper gradient is smaller than this object. Okay? And so now the key is to prove this stability property. Okay, the stability property is not difficult and is based on a lemma which we call the Fouglede lemma. Okay, so now proof of stability. Again, I need an intermediate observation, which we might call Fouglede lemma. Which tells me that from this convergence in L2XM, one obtains convergence on almost every curve. Okay. So the convergence in L2 implies convergence on almost every curve. And if you have this property, okay, you can also assume, without loss of generality, you in case you extract a subsequence, that this convergence also is true almost everywhere. Okay? In case you extract a subsequence in order to achieve this property. And now remember that E0 sharp of pi is absolutely continuous with respect to M as a bounded density, which implies if you have a convergence almost everywhere that Fn of gamma 0 converges to F of gamma 0 for pi almost every curve. So if I fix a test plan, because of the absolute continuity condition which you impose in test plans, you have this convergence for pi almost every curve. But pi is all arbitrary, and so you get this also holds for two almost every curve. Because pi is arbitrary. Analogously, you get that Fn of gamma 1 converges to F of gamma 1 for 2 almost every curve for the same reason. And so you see, we have all the ingredients to pass to the limit in the weak upper gradient inequality, because we simply write we pass to the limit along almost every curve, and we recover the weak upper gradient property. Okay? So this is the proof of stability. And now I show you a short proof of Fugledes' lemma. So why convergence in L2? Actually, here I need a slight refinement. So let me assume not only convergence, but also that I can always achieve this passing to a subsequence. Okay, this is what I'm going to show. I'm going to show that if GH converges to G fastly in L2, in this sense, then you have convergence along almost every curve. Again, this is sufficient for stability because you can always extract a subsequence in order to achieve this property. Okay, so this is what I need to show now. Well, the idea is very simple because you start from a generic curve gamma. And you apply Elder inequality. Times the integral from 0, 1 of a gamma dot square pi dt. Okay? This is just Elder inequality. Okay, now fix pi test plan and assume with no loss of generality that this quantity is finite, is L-infinity, that the action is bounded with respect to pi. You can always assume this because, pi is concentrated on curves for which this is finite, right? So any pi can be monotonically approximated by pi's which have this property. So I need only to check my properties on this class, this slightly smaller class of test plans, for which this function is not L1 but L infinity. Not only L1 but L infinity. Okay, and now I'm going to integrate this inequality with respect to pi. And so I get that the integral on gamma di pi on gamma can be bounded by the integral between 0 and 1, and now I'm using Fubini also. Now, here there is a constant, which comes from the fact that this object is bounded with respect to pi. And then I apply also Fubini here. Okay. And now I have to use in a heavy way the fact that not only the marginals at time 0 and at time 1 are bounded, which is the property I used in the proof of the stability property, but also that all intermediate marginals are bounded, right? So all these integrals can be bounded. So these integrals are with the t fixed, you see? So they can be bounded by a constant, by another constant. So here, the constant C of pi comes into play. The integral of gn minus g square dm. Okay? And here I really use the C of pi for all times between 0 and 1. Okay, and then the proof is done because now I sum with respect to n. And I get that the integral of the sum is finite. Remember that I was assuming that this series is finite with respect to n. And this tells me that this is finite pi almost everywhere, which means, in particular, that the integral on gamma of gn minus g converges to 0 pi almost everywhere. Okay? And of course, eventually, I use the fact that pi is arbitrary, and so the final statement is that this property is true along almost every curve. So you really see in this proof how we used the axiomatization about test plan in a really crucial way. Okay, now we have to start to discuss the non-trivial implication and inclusion. And of course, this inclusion will come with the proof that the gradient star can be bounded by the gradient weak. Okay. Okay. Now let us go back to the classical proof, Meyer-Serring. The proof of Meyer-Serring, you know, is based on convolutions. What would be the role of convolutions in this context? The role of convolution is played by the heat flow. Although non-linear, we will see that it plays the same role. And so why, in some sense, this implication is more difficult? Because, in some sense, the only information, you know that the function is in W, and And so the only information you have on your function is that on almost every curve you have some control of the oscillation of your function. How to this? What you have to do in order to build to show that f is in H, you would like to build fn, which are Lipschitz, which converge to f, and such that the Lindsup is less than the L2 norm of the weak gradient. Okay. So this is what we really have to do. And, well, in fact, I should put quotes here because our proof is not really constructive. So, as we will see in a moment, we have a kind of indirect argument too. We don't have a really an explicit construction. And I think an interesting problem is to see, try to understand whether maybe inside our proof there is a kind of more explicit way of doing things. So our proof is not really constructive. And okay, let me start with some strategy. The strategy, okay, I still have some time before the break. So is to compare energy dissipation rates. Remember that we already computed exactly the energy dissipation rate of the entropy along the heat flow, which was the integral and here we had the star gradient, because the heat flow was done using the Cheeger energy. Okay. This is the result I proved at the beginning of my lecture. And what I'm going to show, using some ideas on optimal, which come from really from optimal transport, is to show that there is a sharper estimate on the energy dissipation rate. You can bound it by 1/2 of the star gradient plus 1/2 of the relaxed gradient of the weak gradient. And so in some sense, this estimate is sharper than this one, because a priori, for the moment, we have only the information that this object is larger than the weak gradient. Okay, so this is better than this one. And so in particular, this implies that along the heat flow, along the heat flow, the two gradients coincide. Just comparing the two expressions and knowing that one is larger than the other. Okay? And then there is a more delicate argument that I will not explain, which tells you that we can extend this property up to time zero. Here I just want to illustrate the idea which leads to the fact that along the heat flow the two objects coincide, and then a refinement of these arguments, which however is beyond the scope of these lectures, gives you that really you can reach time zero. Okay, and so now I'm going to show you. And basically, here in the proof of this fact, there are two tools. Say Eulerian to Lagrangian. And the first tool is the so-called superposition principle. And the second tool is an important lemma which we borrowed from a paper of Kuvada, and so we started to call, because of its importance, we started to call it Kuvada lemma. Okay, maybe before the break I just illustrate what is the superposition principle and then we make a break. Let's start, as usual, I will start from the classical case in Rn. And then we are going to see the metric version of this fact. Okay, so in Rn, what is the idea? You start from a solution to the continuity equation. Again, remember, for me, t is always an index. So I have a velocity field depending on time and space. I have a time-dependent family of probability measures. And I impose some integrability condition on the velocity. The meaning of the continuity equation is that really you are describing the action, the evolution of this density of particles under the velocity, under and these particles move under the action of this velocity field. So how can we make this precise, right? How we can go from this description, which is Eulerian, to a Lagrangian description, which is the one I was giving before in words? Well, there is a theorem, which surprisingly does not require, well, this theorem has a long history. I mean, the first version is due to L.C. Young. Then it was revisited in the context of currents by Smirnov. And in the context which is relevant for me on solutions to the continuity equation was revisited again in my book with Gillier and Savaret. So I will give you our version. And the statement is that given mu t vt as before, you can always find a probability measure, maybe I will call it pi, on AC2. Such that, first of all, precisely if you look to ET sharp of pi for all times, this is precisely mu t. And the second property is that pi is concentrated precisely on solutions to the ordinary differential equations. So in, you see that in this way we can really make rigorous this interpretation. And also the converse is true. Any pi with these two properties, of course, it's not difficult to show, gives rise to a distribution of solutions to the continuity equation. Okay, I think maybe we can make the break here, and after the break I will start with the metric version of this statement. Okay, so let's see now what is the metric counterpart, of this result. Well, if you are in a metric space, actually here only the metric is involved, not the measure in this statement. So there is no reference measure. What is the replacement of this condition? Well, this is replaced by the notion of absolutely continuous curve. Px. So it will be a curve of measures with values, so in P of x, precisely absolutely continuous if you take the vastest time distance, the distance of that Guido was illustrating this morning. So this object plays exactly the role of this object in Rn. And in fact, in our book, where we were dealing in Rn, we precisely proved that this description and this description are perfectly equivalent in Rn. But the advantage of this description is, of course, that it makes sense in any metric space. And then the state, so we are not given a velocity field a priori, but then the statement is exactly the same. So exists pi, which is concentrated is a probability measures on AC2 with the right marginals. And then we have to at least to mimic a little bit the counterpart of statement 2. And what we can show is that the integral so you see the velocity of course plays the role of V now, because at least the metric velocity occurs. So this gives me a function of t. And this function of t is precisely the metric derivative of this family of curves, right? So this is a curve in the space of measures, absolutely continuous, so it takes its metric derivative. And the metric derivative is precisely squared, is precisely the mean value of the speed of course at time t. Okay, well, in this statement, which we call metric superposition principle, is due to a PhD student of Savaré, Lissini, it appeared on Calcvar, PD. I remember well in 2009. Okay, so in particular, okay, let's say where we are going to apply the Lissini theorem, and let me make the connection with the test plans. In particular, what we are going to do next. So we are going to apply Lissini theorem to these curve meshes. And with F0 we will see in a moment that this, so where F is the solution to the heat, the heat flow, and remember that these properties are retained, in particular because of the L-infinity bound and because of this condition, T sharp of pi equal to mu t and so this will be a test plan. And so for my function in W I know that I'm going to control the oscillation of the function along pi almost every curve. Okay, so this is the plan. This is what we are going to do. But why are we allowed to apply Licini theorem to the solution to the heat equation? The reason is that now it comes into play the Kuvada lemma, which is the second key connection between Eulerian and Lagrangian. So under the previous notation, mu t equal f t, Kuvada lemma says that mu t belongs to AC2, let's say 0, let's say plus infinity, because the heat flow is defined for all time with values in p of x, w2. And what is even more important is that I can bound the metric derivative of this curve precisely with the star gradient. So here you will find again, you will find again the Fisher information. Okay, so now let me give you the proof of the Kuvada lemma. Okay, the proof is based on the duality formula in optimal transportation. I don't know if we'd already stated it or yes. So did Guido state the duality formula in optimal transportation? Okay, so I can, let me just rewrite it. Let me remind you, and I will write the duality formula in a convenient way. So the duality formula tells me that W2 square between mu and nu is the supremum of the integral of, okay, let me use here. In the nu minus, okay, maybe C in the nu minus the integral of phi in the mu, where the supremum runs among all pairs, let's say psi and phi, which are Lipschitz. And the constraint is, of course, that psi minus phi, psi of y minus phi of x should be smaller than the cost function, which in my case is always the square of the distance. Okay? This is what... Okay, so it will be convenient for me to write this formula only maximizing with respect to phi. So if I only maximize with respect to phi, you see here I have to put the largest possible psi compatible with phi. What is the largest possible psi compatible with phi? It will be, so, okay, maybe I write this here. The maximal psi given phi is, well, you immediately see, okay, there is a 1/2 somewhere. Okay, let me put in this way. It will be more convenient for me to write in this way. Okay, given phi, the maximal psi is the infimum on x of phi of x plus d square over 2. And actually, this is a particular case, is the case t equal 1 of a famous formula, which is called the Hopf-Lax formula, so or a famous semigroup, which is the Hopf-Lax semigroup, which is typically denoted by qt. So let me put again a time variable here, because it will be important. Qt of phi, for me, will be the infimum on x of phi of x plus 1 over 2t d square xy. Okay? So at time zero, this is really a semigroup, so at time zero this is the identity. And this formula, of course, corresponds to Q1. Okay, and now I write this formula in this way. I'm maximizing only in one variable, phi, and this is the integral of Q1 phi d nu minus the integral of phi d nu. And then what I would like to do now is to use this formula to estimate the vastness and distance. Okay, so let me give you an estimate between, let's say, mu0 and mu1. So let's take mu0 equal to f0. M, mu1 equal to f1 m, right? So this will be my mu, nu will be f1, where ft, as usual, is the solution to the heat flow. And let's see how we can get an estimate of the distance using the Fisher information. To get this estimate, I need also an additional property of the Hopf-Lax semigroup. It is called Hopf-Lax semigroup. This is a definition. And, this was a property well known in Rn, but surprisingly remains true basically in any metric space, that this family of functions solves a first order PDE in a pointwise sense. And precisely, it's the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. So here you have the slope, the pointwise Lipschitz constant. So this is true pointwise. And actually, well, there are many refinements of these results to say that also there is the equality for almost every x and almost every t, but for the purpose of this proof, I only need the pointwise inequality. If you look in our papers, you will find a more precise statement about also the equality case. So we only use the fact that the Hopflux formula is a subsolution to the metric Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Metric because it involves the slope. Okay, and then I fix a function phi in leap 1x, in leap x, and I want to estimate q1 phi d mu 1 minus phi d mu 0. Okay, so it's tempting here to write this in this way, here with the q0 phi d mu 0. And to imagine that there is a time variable in between, right? This is why I wrote this in this expression in this way, right? And so this is the integral of d over dt, the integral between 0 and 1 of d over dt of the integral of qt phi d mu t. And now I can use on one side, of course here there is a kind of Leibniz rule to be applied, right? So I can use on this side the Hamilton-Jacobi subsolution. On this side I will use, of course, the heat equation. So let's write explicitly the derivatives. So this is the integral between 0 and 1 of d over dt dqt phi d mu t. Okay, maybe I will start to use also ft. I will use also the densities plus the integral of qt phi delta ft dm dt. So I simply applied the Leibniz rule, which of course can be justified in this case. And now here I'm going to apply the integration by parts. So this will be equal. So I'm going to apply on one side the integration by parts. And on the other side, I'm going to use the subsolution property. So this is less than the integral between 0 and 1 of the integral of minus 1 half dqt phi square ft dm. And here I integrate by parts, and here I get plus, okay, let me group these two now together, plus, and here I get the gradient. This integration by parts, of course, involves the Cheeger calculus, so here I should use the star derivatives. Dm dt. Okay. But now I know that the star derivative is smaller than the slope. Again, because the slope is an upper gradient, and so, for a Lipschitz function, the star derivative is smaller than the slope by definition. So this inequality remains true if I put a star here, because I'm putting a small object with a negative sign. And then I apply the Young inequality to get 1 half the integral between 0 and 1 of the integral between or the integral of, so you see, then qt phi disappears because I'm going to apply the Young inequality, and I get the integral of dft star over ft dm. And remember the expression we started with. We started from many Lipschitz function phi. Eventually, it disappeared from the estimate. And then I can take the supremum. So by taking the supremum, with respect to x, gives that 1/2 W2 square between mu 0 and mu 1 is less than 1/2 integral between 0 and 1 And this is almost exactly the Kuvada lemma up to a time localization, right? It's a kind of integral version. It's a kind of integral version of Kuvada lemma. I can remove, of course, the two. If you apply this kind of inequality not between time zero and time one, but between two arbitrary times, remember that you have the semigroup property, so you can start from any time and continue for an arbitrary time. You can also rescale time. This inequality, basically, up to rescaling, gives you that the time derivative square is less than the Fisher information. But there is a star here. So in a sense, this is the pointwise version, this is the integral version, but one can go from one to the other via a time scaling. For almost every t. Okay, so this gives me Kuvada lemma. Okay, and now I can combine these two to get the sharp energy dissipation rate, which will complete my discussion about the equivalence of Sobolev spaces. Okay, I rewrite the energy dissipation rate again. I want to estimate from above minus the derivative of ft log ft dm. Ft is the usual solution to the heat equation with 1/2 of the star derivative. Plus 1/2 of the weak derivative. Okay. Okay, and the idea of the proof is actually a refinement. The idea comes from a refinement of the estimate on the slope of the entropy that you can find, for instance, in Villani's book. So really, here many ideas come. Also, the idea of using the entropy, of course, comes from optimal transport. And tomorrow we will see why all these things are related not only to Sobol spaces but also to slope of the entropy and other relations. Okay, here I just wanted to mention the origin of the idea. Okay, so let's say that we fix two times s less than t. And I want to estimate the oscillation of the entropy between these two times. So it is Ft log Ft dm minus Fs log of Fs ds. You see, the signs are inverted precisely because I want to estimate minus the derivative. Okay, so first of all, there is a pointwise dm. Sorry. Well, first of all, there is a pointwise convexity inequality. So the pointwise convexity inequality is that b log b minus a log a, just by convexity or the log of this function, can be estimated by b plus 1 log log 1 plus log b times b minus a. Okay, it's just a pointwise inequality which comes out of convexity. That is a subdifferential inequality, actually, that you can check. You just integrate this inequality for almost every x, and you get that, first of all, you can bound this oscillation with plus log, 1 plus log of Ft times Ft minus Fs dm. Okay. Now, if you want, since all these functions have integral equal to 1, we can immediately drop this constant 1, which plays no role. I mean, that cancels. And now I start to use all the tools that I introduced before. So first of all, I can view Ft and the Fs as the marginals of pi. So take now pi given by Lissini theorem.
Sorry, here is the pointwise, like Ft is bigger than Fs. Because if you want to use this, I need actually Ft bigger than.
You mean in this pointwise inequality? No, I think this is true for any a and b. I think this is a pointwise inequality, of course a and b positive. Yeah, I think this is a general inequality. Yeah, I have no pointwise information between the order ft of x and fs of x. Yeah. Okay, so now let me pi given by Lissini, which, again, I can apply this in theorem because I have Kuvada lemma, which tells me that this curve is absolutely continuous. And so I can view Ft as the projection of some pi. And so I can write this integral as the integral of 1 plus log of f of gamma t. Log of Ft, I keep this as a constant function, and here I put instead f of gamma t minus f of gamma s. Oh, okay, maybe the proof becomes more transparent if I give a name to this function. Let me call phi this function, because the time t will be fixed for me. So this is the integral of phi ft and And so this will become phi of gamma t minus phi of gamma s d pi of gamma. Okay? I simply use the fact that the marginals of pi are given by Ft, m, and Fs of m. And you see, now I am precisely in a situation when I can apply the theory of weak upper gradients, right? Because I know that my function phi belongs to the W Sobolev space by chain rule. And by chain rule, I know that d phi w, the chain rule is true also for the w Sobolev spaces, is equal to 1 over ft times the weak gradient. Okay? And so I can now estimate this integral with the integral of the integral between S and T of d phi w of gamma r dot gamma r dr d pi of gamma. Okay. And now I apply the Young inequality. This is where the 1/2, 1/2 comes from. I apply Young. And I'm going to estimate separately in different ways the two terms which come out of the Young inequality. So let me first write the kinetic term. So this will be less than 1/2 the integral of the integral between S and T Okay, I skip a step and I also apply Fubini. Dr plus 1/2. Also here I apply Fubini after applying Young. And here I get the integral Now, remember that this is the kind of mean kinetic energy, which by Fubini, by Licini theorem, this is equal. So I continue with an inequality, but here I just replace 1/2 the integral between S and T of the metric derivative of this curve square. Here I apply Licini theorem. Remember that the Licini theorem tells me that precisely that this object is the metric derivative. And here, maybe here I could start using the chain rule to simplify. Here I apply the fact that the marginals at time r are given by fr. So here I write it in this way. So this pi now will disappear. S and t of the integral of d phi w square times fr dm dr. Okay, so you see now pi disappeared because I used the information that er ds is of pi is equal to fr. Okay, now I can continue one more step, but we are almost done, because now I apply Kuvada to get here the relaxed gradient. So here I simply estimated the derivative with the expression, with the Fisher information given by Kubala lemma. And here now I apply the chain rule. So we get plus 1/2 integral between S and T of the integral of the weak gradient of Ft square divided by Ft squared, right? Because this is the derivative squared of phi times Fr dm dr. Okay, and now let us examine what happens when S converges to T. So you remember that we wanted to estimate the derivative of this quantity. So think that we are dividing now by T minus S and we are taking limits, right? If you divide by T minus S and you take limits, here you get what you wanted, so 1/2 of the star gradient. And here you get a slightly different expression because you get, if you divide here, you get something which goes like Ft squared over Ft squared times Fr. But as S goes to T, also R goes to T, so this is again, and this can be proved rigorously by kind of weak convergence arguments. You can prove that this goes exactly like the Fw square over Ft as S converges to T. And so you get precisely 1/2, so the Fisher information, but written with the weak gradient. And so you get precisely the sharp energy dissipation estimate that I wrote. Okay, and so more or less this completes the proof of all these connections between Sobolev, different definitions of Sobolev spaces. Actually, a byproduct of this proof more or less with similar arguments. Okay, let me introduce now also, in preparation of tomorrow's lecture, let me introduce also another notion of slope, which will play a role in tomorrow's lecture, which is the so-called descending slope. Remember that if you have a function y, if you have a metric space y, dy, and you have had the function, let's say, g, from y to r, we define the slope of g at y as the lin sup as z goes to y of the modulus of g of z minus g of y divided by d z y. In the theory of gradient flows, also in the theory that I illustrated for maximal monotone operators in my first lecture, there is another notion of slope which is more convenient, which is the one where you take here the negative part. So we'll denote this by d minus. It is the so-called descending slope. So this only measures how much you are able to decrease the value of your function. You don't care of how much you can increase it. So it's simply, again, the lin sup as z goes to y. But here I take the negative part, which is non-negative, but according to the standard convention. So, okay. So in particular, if you are, for instance, at the minimum point of G, no matter if, for instance, if you have a corner or you, the descending slope occurs at minimum points is equal to zero. Because you can't decrease even more your functional. And this is particularly appropriate, as we will see tomorrow in the theory of gradient flows, also from the point of view of the classical theory, for instance, of the Brezis theory. The Brezis theory that I illustrated in the first lecture, for instance, because one can show that for a convex lower semi-continuous functional, the minimum norm remember, we were speaking about convex lower semi-continuous functions in Hilbert spaces. And if you take the element with minimal norm, which we call the gradient, by definition, this was called the gradient of phi. And this can also be shown to be equivalent to the, not to the slope of the functional, but to the descending slope of the functional. Now, since tomorrow we are going to speak about the gradient flows also in metric spaces, of course we can't use the subdifferential, we can't use scalar products and so on, but this will be a good replacement, right? This purely metric version will be relevant in the theory of gradient flows, and it is perfectly consistent with the classical picture. And so, as I was saying, a byproduct of the proof I gave you is that we have a precise relation between Fisher information and slope of the entropy. And the relation is that the Fisher information of course here now we can put star W because we know now that these two objects are the same. You want. So the Fisher information is always smaller than the slope of the entropy. Square. And in tomorrow's lecture, where we will talk a little bit about the gradient flows and the CDKN theory, we will examine more closely this connection. Of course, without any other assumptions, we don't expect equality here. Remember that we saw this kind of pathological examples where all these gradients trivialize, so they are identically equal to zero. So we cannot expect that there is equality here in general. But we will see that under curvature conditions, this is true. And these two objects are the same. And again, you see this is an important connection between a Lagrangian point of view and the Eulerian point of view, which is inside here. Actually, yeah, here I should specify, of course, this is a functional in P of X, right? And so when you are going to compute the descending slope, you have to use the Wasserstein distance. So here we are really taking as functional G the entropy, and as space y, precisely the space of probability measures with the Wasserstein distance. Okay, and I think maybe today I will stop just a few minutes earlier, and tomorrow we resume from a new subject.